When I was about 9 years old, I got stuck on a Peter Pan amusement park ride with my dad. And there's a part of the ride where you're in this flying pirate ship and you're soaring over a miniature London. And I got stuck there for about 25 minutes. And I remember sitting there with my dad and looking down at London, and Peter and Wendy are sort of off at arm's reach flying in the distance. And I had a million questions about why Peter Pan was Peter Pan and how he got to Neverland and how he learned to fly. And I was sort of mystified by why he and Captain Hook hated each other so much. I had a hard time wrapping my mind around what that was all about. And so really since I was 9, I was fascinated by the story and by the Peter Pan mythology and had lots of ideas about where it had all started. And 20 years of thinking about that ultimately led me to, in the summer of 2013, pitching this as a script idea and saying, hey, what if we made a movie that finally told the untold story of how the Peter Pan mythology began, of why he's Peter Pan, of why he and Hook hate each other, and Pan sort of organically developed from there. I was very shocked at every point in this process. As a writer, you're shocked when someone buys your script. So when I found out the pitch was being bought by Warner Brothers, I thought, well, this is great. This is not going to go any further, obviously. But just the fact that it's been bought is kind of a cool thing. And then suddenly I'd handed in the script and it had this very positive response to the studio. And we found out it was going to be on the blacklist, which is this Hollywood list of unproduced screenplays that people seem to like. And I thought, well, that's a swell thing. The script has been well received and that's got to be a good deal. And then all of a sudden, Joe Wright is signing on to direct. And then you're thinking, okay, this is really too good to be true. Because a guy like Joe Wright seems like an almost impossible director to get to direct something like this. He's never done family entertainment. He's never done something sort of more commercial and tentpole and mainstream like this. And so now you're thinking, well, wow, we have our dream director. There's no way we're going to get a cast that lives up to this. And it's about a month after that you get the call and they go, you know, Hugh Jackman has always wanted to play a pirate. And you go, oh, okay. Well, we've got a pirate for you, and his name is Blackbeard. And suddenly you're on set in the middle of the Neverwood, and you're literally walking through what a year ago was just in your own head, and it's a very surreal and a thrilling and extraordinary experience. And I think that's going to be true for audiences as well. I mean, Neverland really is a world out of pure imagination. And I think the experience of sitting in that theater is not going to be all that different from that first moment of me stepping into the Neverwood on that set up in Cardington. Joe Wright is just about the most talented director I've ever seen. He is such a brilliant, mad genius of a guy. He takes everything to another level visually. He fell in love with the script. He understood the characters. He understood what I was trying to do, and then had constantly inventive and surprising ways of taking it to a place I couldn't have imagined. You know, I think about the opening sequence, for instance, when the kids are stolen from the Lambeth Home Orphanage. And I'd written that as a scene where I had the notion that these kids were being sucked out the windows and taken hostage and thrown on the ship. But Joe sat down and looked at this and said, well, hold on a second. What if we had the pirates dropping down on bungee cords and flying up through the skylight? And as a writer getting that note, you sit there and go, oh my God, this is, I could never have thought of something so cool and brilliant. And yes, let's do that immediately. And there were just moments throughout the process where Joe was able to find visual moments, beats, that just transcended anything you would normally see in a mainstream Hollywood studio feature. But I think the other thing that made Joe such a special pick for this was that Joe understood, underneath all the action and the adventure and the special effects driven stuff, this was a very relatable story that at the end of the day was about an orphan, a boy, just trying to find his mom. And he locked into that from day one and understood that it was his mission to sort of protect that core emotional journey in the middle of this very loud, very bright, very big action-adventure film. One other reason I think that Joe was kind of the perfect match of director and material is that Joe has this beyond adorable, precocious young son, Zubin, and he really, I think, was looking for an opportunity to make something for him, to make something that his son could see, to make something that kids could really, really be transported by. And for him, Pan was that opportunity, and he made something, I think, that not only Zubin is going to love, but kids of all ages from 8 to 80 around the world, I think, are going to respond to in a pretty special way. Hugh brings a sense of theatricality to the role of Blackbeard that is very appropriate for the Blackbeard we've invented for this world. Blackbeard, in the original Peter Pan J. Barrie book, makes a very brief, almost non-appearance. There's one line on page 53 that says, James Hook trained as a bosun on The Queen Anne's Revenge under Blackbeard. And so I read that and thought, oh, well, that's our bad guy. He's part of the DNA of this Barry mythology. We're going to find a way to include him. And so from that I went, well, if you had Blackbeard arriving in Neverland, what would he do? He'd become this kind of tyrannical dictator. He'd become this crazy, power-mad thing. And what Hugh added to that equation was a sense of play and a sense of theatricality where he thought, how does he trick these kids? These kids, they outnumber him. He has all these miners slaving away in the dust mines. He has these pirates who, you know, numerically outnumber him. How does he maintain this almost Svengali-like hold on them? And the answer was, he is a showman. He entertains, he enchants them. And I think that also brings a wonderful sense of humor to what could have been a purely terrifying role. And it's that combination of comedy and fear that's what I think sets Blackbeard apart from a lot of movie villains. Joe assembled an all-star team to build the world of Neverland in Pan. Jacqueline Duran designed our wardrobe. Aline Bonetto was our production designer. And I've never seen a world fleshed out in the way that Joe fleshed out Neverland. And I think his operating sort of guiding principle was, yes, it's a world out of someone's imagination. It is a dreamland, but we want this to feel like a real, tangible place, a place you can reach out and touch and visit and be a part of. And so that really sort of set the tone for how we built the world, and we practically built sets. You know, the trend right now is to build CGI sort of computer-generated worlds, and Joe said, no, we're going to build the Neverwood. We're going to take over a shed in Cardington they used to build World War II airships, and we're going to build 4.5 blocks of the forest. We're going to build 3 decks of actual pirate ships. And it just sort of, it's both overwhelming in person and on screen, and it makes you feel like just maybe this is a world you actually could visit. When I was building the script, I was deeply influenced by the original Peter Pan book. I love the Jay Barry book. I was read it at a very early age by my mom. And so for me, I wanted this to feel like it was an organic extension of it. I wanted you to watch Pan and feel like this was not a version of what could have happened before the Peter Pan story, but this was definitive. This was the untold story of how Peter actually became Peter Pan, how he actually met Hook, how he got to Neverland. And so that really my guiding light as I wrote this throughout the entire process was, is this something that feels like it's of a piece with the original Barry book? And I hope audiences feel like we did an okay job of accomplishing that.